Still overcast and cool, but as much as I'm missing the sun, the more active the leopards, the bigger smile on my face. So she has, oh Karula, I've seen her 3 or 4 times put a kill in a specific tree, and you can just see it through there. If we come up a little bit, that big African ebony there. So let's go see if we can get there. Now of course it's a lot thicker than it was a couple of weeks ago after all the rain. Oh, don't fly too much. And you, just before we get going, there's a butterfly there, sort of on my finger, and just, oh, slow down, let it go a little bit up, I think. Oh, it's through. Oh, where to go? And it's one I haven't showed you before. It's called a zebra. It's, oh, there it is. It's flying. You see it flying? It's flapping around there. There we go. Oh, and it's, strange enough, not black and white. It's more yellow and white. Oh, still a bit damp, so probably the wings aren't too dry. Lovely little butterfly. Now let's go find some leopards. Oh, has he landed? Okay, there we go. Now, of course, I might be wrong, and Karula is not in that tree with a kill. She could be somewhere else under a thicket. So we are going to enlist the help of Jamie and Herbie on foot to come help check this area. So let's go say hello to Jamie.
That sounds like an amazing plan for our afternoon bushwalk. There's nothing like seeing and tracking leopards on foot. A very good afternoon to all of you and welcome on our sunset safari. My name is Jamie and this afternoon the gentleman bringing you all of the wonderful camera work is Viam. And of course, as Brent mentioned, we have Herbie who has already vanished off into the distance. And Herbie helps to keep us safe, make sure that we don't go wandering into any animals. But before we get into too much detail, a very warm welcome to the kids joining us from Longdon, Shelton Park and Sunderland Elementary Schools. It is lovely to have you on board. I hope you're all very, very excited. I remember what you're seeing here is happening right here and right now in the afternoon in South Africa. Now there we go, from Mr. Shaw, while we get up and start moving. Mr. Shaw, you want to know where in South Africa we are located. We're located on the sort of western fringes of a world-renowned reserve known as the Greater Kruger National Park. So it's up in the sort of the top northeastern corner of South Africa, and it stretches right up to border alongside Mozambique and Zimbabwe, divided, or sort of the border of which is delineated by the Limpopo River. So that's where we are, top corner of South Africa. And of course, South Africa, as its name suggests for all you kids, is at the southernmost point of Africa. So we are in the southern hemisphere. It is obviously summer here, in theory. It's so supposed to be summer here. We haven't seen the sun in a little while, but that's actually really wonderful news. Because as you saw earlier, we've had plenty of rain. The grass is looking lush and green, which makes us very happy because South Africa has recently been in a really, really bad drought. Possibly, some people said, the worst drought in the last 100 or so years. Although it seems as though the rain that we've had this rainy season has definitely helped us. And we've actually got two seasons here, essentially. We don't really get the proper spring, summer, autumn, winter. We really have our wet season, which is in our hotter months, our summer months, and the dry season, which is our winter months. And during the dry season, we generally don't see much in the way of clouds or rain. Sometimes it drizzles 1 or 2 days, but other than that, we don't see much rain. So this afternoon, Brent's told you, we are looking for a leopard. And it's much easier for us to search on foot because we can sort of move through and go where the vehicles can go, but it's much easier for us to go on foot. Now, Talia, you want to know whether or not there are any animals that migrate seasonally in Africa. Yes, there are lots of different animals that migrate. There are animals in this reserve that will move to different places depending on what month it is and what food is available where. There is, of course, the famous migration of the animals in East Africa, so Tanzania, Kenya, and they will move, depending on whether it is the wet season or the dry season, across rivers, across plains, and there'll be thousands and thousands of animals that will be running along like that. And then, birds. Birds is the big one. Birds are the ones that really cover the huge distances. Some of the birds come all the way from Europe and from Russia, right down south to South Africa during our summer months. And the reason that they do that is because summer months we get this insect explosion and they come through for food. Then we get the Amur falcons that fly through India and then all the way along Africa and down to us. So birds are the big ones that migrate. Now we suspect that this leopard is somewhere in this general direction. So you'll see Herbie over there. He's scouting ahead to make sure we don't walk into anything while I'm talking to you, because I might be concentrating on your questions and I might not have seen something. All right. Let us go and search and see what we can find. Now, Hayley, you want to know if there are any poisonous plants out here. Hayley, yes, there's quite a few different poisonous plants. And generally, it's a good rule of thumb not to eat something if you don't know what it is. So there's things called tamburti trees. Now, a tamburti tree is probably one of the most toxic things out here. Now, you wouldn't really go up to a tree and just eat the leaves. But even if you burn the wood of a tamburti tree, it's got a milky white latex in it, sort of a milky white substance. And unfortunately, this isn't the right area to show you a tamburti, because if I find a tamburti here, it's a bit lost. They like to be near rivers or near river systems. But even if you burn the wood, smelling the smoke, or if you cook food on the fire made from that wood, you're going to find yourself very, very sick indeed. So there is a very toxic plant called the tamburti. There is something called milkweed, which is also very toxic to human beings. And there's a few bulbs and tubers that are also quite poisonous as well. So as a good general rule, you don't really want to try and eat something out here unless you know exactly what it is. We've got mushrooms growing everywhere at the moment. Of course, as I say, everywhere, I can't find one. There are so many mushrooms around, and those are also quite toxic. But Spencer, and by toxic I mean it can kill you in a few hours. Spencer, you want to know what types of trees are around us. Well, Spencer, one of the big things that we see, the sort of the dominant trees in this area, are trees called marula trees. And there's three species that dominate this particular open area. Marula trees, which produce delicious fruit. That is a marula tree in front of you. And then we get apple leaves in this clearing. And then a tree called a silver cluster leaf. So probably not trees that you're familiar with, probably not trees that you've heard the names of, but trees that are very, very common for us to see out here. And bear in mind that even in this sort of vast savanna, there are different types of ecosystem, different types of soil types, different types of vegetation types, depending on where they are. So where I am now, this nice big open area, I know that just a little bit further to the southwest of me, there is a seep line where the water runs underneath the ground. And the reason that I know that is because that's why the silver cluster leaves grow there. So that's how I know. That's one of the indicator species. If I go a little bit to the east of me, I'll get to basically a river known as the Mulwati. It's dry, there's no water flowing, but that's where you're going to get big trees like leadwoods, jackalberry, which is basically the African equivalent of the ebony tree, and all sorts of the really nice big trees. And then most dominant throughout this whole area is a type of tree called the bush willow. You get lots of different types of bush willow, and they all have, I must try and find one for you. I don't think I'm going to find one right here, but if I try and find you the seeds, they've all got four wings on either side of them, so that when the wind blows, it's time for the seed to disperse, they can blow in the wind and go and land somewhere different and hopefully produce more bush willow trees. So we've got lots and lots of bush willows. And that's the nice thing about going on the walk, is that you actually get to see all kinds of exciting things, because you're close to the ground, you're looking for interesting things to show you, well, interesting things to see, and you're not making noise as you are in the vehicle. So it really just gives you a lovely opportunity to examine things nice and close up. All right, I want to go and find out what Brent is up to. Let's go and have a look.
Well, we're in the middle of the bush. I'm just trying to chat to Herbie at the moment. He's trying to get hold of me. Herbie's standing by. One sati and mampimpan, or just one sat? Okay, so I'm just getting update on the tracks from Herbie. So he's got tracks of just the female, but we need tracks of the female and the two cubs because we saw them all together. Yeah, Herbie, I think that was when she was hunting maybe this morning. I'm gonna keep checking to where this tawny eagle is in the Shkova. So now I've spotted a bird. I'll try to see if I can show it to you now. Called a tawny eagle. Now, it's a very big eagle, but they've also got really good eyesight, and they are often the first to spot a kill. So, and they'll hang around and wait for the leopards to leave so they can get some scraps. And we're sitting down there. As you can see, this is really thick bush. Now, if you see me drive over a tree, don't worry, it bounces back up behind me. Now, Deshaun is wondering, has a leopard ever chased me? Well, not yet, Deshaun. I've been charged, but the most important thing if an animal comes growling and snarling at you in the bush is not to run. You need to stand your ground. Now, that eagle was sitting in that dead tree over there. So there's a nice big timbuerti tree which leopards like. So the eagle was there, but it's gone. So I'm hoping the leopards are below that tree. It's all well saying that, but getting in there is a different story. Okay, well, we keep looking. Let's go meet Tayla, who's also out there.
Good job. Sorry for our long day. We've been driving around searching for lots of wonderful things. My name is Tayla, and on camera, and I must know you.
To us. Oh, whoopsie daisy, sorry about that everybody. It seems as though Tayla has disappeared off your screens, and that's just the reality of bringing you a live safari. Sometimes something goes wrong and the signal disappears. And Wendy's the vehicle that Taylor's on. Wendy's been a little bit temperamental over the last few days, let's just put it at that. Herbie tells me that he's found tracks over here. We're going to go and have a look and see if we can spot them. Now, that's one of the ways that we find the big cats. Well done, thank you, Herbie. It's one of the ways that we find the big cats is by following their footprints. And sometimes that's really hard to do, especially on a day like today where it's really cloudy. Now, believe it or not, that over there is a leopard track. And it's really difficult to see. So what I'm going to do is just draw the outline for you, because this might be your first leopard track. I'm going to assume it's your first leopard track. So let me show you what you're looking at. This is the back of its foot. One, two, three. So it's got, instead of having just one bump at the back of the foot like a human being, it's got three. And then one toe here, one toe here, one toe here, and one toe here. So that's how big a leopard track is. Basically, a female leopard's track is the size of my palm. A male leopard track is going to be double that size. And Carly, you want to know how much do leopards eat? And Carly, they Well, it depends on whether it's a male or a female. It depends on if it's fully grown or not. Generally, a leopard will eat roughly every 2 to 3 days, or kill something roughly every 2 to 3 days. And then it will eat around about a 5 to 10% of its body weight. So if it's a 40 kilogram female, it will, so that's about 80 pounds, it will eat about close to 10 pounds of food in one sitting. And that could be stretched out over several hours. Whereas for a male, if they are close to 200 pounds, they can eat much, much more, even close to up to 20 pounds of food. So that's how much they'll eat in one go. Now, the thing about this leopard that we're tracking is she's actually got two cubs with her. And her two cubs are basically as big as she is now. They're a year old. Her male cub is definitely as big as she is. Her female cub's a little bit smaller, but either way, they're both essentially the leopard equivalent of teenagers, which or just before the sort of the teenage phase. So they are hungry all the time because they're growing really fast. Now, she's going this way. I can't see any other tracks of the others, but this soil is so hard. If you look here, that's why we need somebody like Herbie. Look here, when I step there, you can only see a little bit of the track. Sophia, you want to know how fast a leopard can run? Let me show you. So a leopard can cover round about close to 60 feet per second. So if VM stays over there, I'm gonna walk 20 steps. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. This is how far away I am. Now, leopard can probably cover that distance in a second. That is how fast. If a leopard is going really, really fast, 1 second, and it's taking Viam, and he's going really quickly. Took Viam, that was very good, Viam, well done. Very impressive. But that probably took Viam about 4 or 5 seconds. Leopard can do it in the blink of an eye. So they're super fast. But that's only when they're really going fast. If they're trying to run away from something, or they're running towards something. So they're not long distance marathon runners. They can't sprint for long periods of time. They are ambush hunters, and they only really reach that top speed for a few meters, and then it's done. So they generally are not going to cover that whole distance running if they've missed whatever they're hunting. And that's why leopards use camouflage, because they sneak up as close as possible to their prey. They've got to hide away and then creep up at it, because they've got to be really close. Otherwise, an antelope, an impala, anything like that that the leopard might want to eat will get away from them. Diana, you want to know what the most popular, did I get that right, Rebecca? Popular animal. Uh-huh. I did get that right. Sorry, Diana. Sometimes I don't hear exactly clearly exactly what your question was. Diana, what is the most popular animal? That's a difficult one, because everybody comes to see different things. You get some people that have seen leopards and lions and elephants before, and all they want to see is, for example, a really special bird. They want to come and see something different. So it very much just depends on the person. But usually, tourists want to see lions, leopards, elephants, buffalo, rhino, cheetah, wild dog. A wild dog is the South African equivalent of the wolf. My shoelace is undone, I'm sorry. I will fall over if I walk with my shoelace undone. And that would be tragic. Hilarious, but equally tragic. And this is to protect me from the ticks as well. What is the most popular animal? VM loves leopards. I love rhino. I like to spend time with elephants as well. So it's very much a personality thing. Diana, what would you say is the most popular animal where you're from? Because of course you also have some extraordinary wildlife in your country. It just depends very much on the individual person. People love to see leopard though. I've noticed that tourists often feel a very strong connection with trying to find them. Maybe it's just because it's hard to find them. Maybe it's just because it's unusual. Now, up ahead of us, just on the other side of Viam, is a big pile of dung. And I'm going to ask you a hard question. Because it doesn't have a shape anymore, it's quite old, what is it? What do you suppose deposited this in the road? Have a look and see what's inside it. Are you all going ew gross? I think you might be all going ew gross. That's quite disgusting. But it's okay, because I can see from its size that it is a herbivore. And that is all I'm going to tell you. There's a bug in there. And there's something else that I want to show you. Sorry, Rebecca. There's something else. What on earth is that? It looks terrifying. There's something else in here that I want to show you. Here we go. So it's not just grass. There's a piece of fruit in there as well. So what do you think might have made this pile of dung? So never ever touch any excrement from any animal unless an adult has told you it's okay. I will wash my hands afterwards. It's exactly what I shall do. And never ever touch dog feces or dog scat, dog poo. Don't touch cat poo. That stuff is really dangerous and you can get really sick. Herbivores is not too much of a problem. Right, well, speaking of herbivores and carnivores, I'm going to go in search of a spotted carnivore and help Brent out. Let's find out how he's doing.
Well, I've checked that whole little river system. It seems like she must have moved further to the west. So let's do that. We're going to go check the next road along to make sure her tracks don't cross there. Hi, Tayla. Tayla would like to know, do leopards migrate? No, they don't. They're territorial animals, Tayla. So a female has a territory in this area of about 2,000 acres, 2,500 acres, and a male up to about 10,000 acres. And once they have that territory, they will stay in that territory and they will fight other leopards to make sure they can't come into that territory. So they don't migrate. Now, hello, Arjana. Arjana would like to know, what do leopards eat? Well, they eat small to medium-sized antelope, so animals about the same size as a white-tailed deer and smaller. Sometimes they can catch bigger ones, sometimes they can catch smaller ones, but their favorite size is about the size of a white-tailed deer, which is an impala, and so the answer is they eat meat. Okay, we're going to check carefully along here, make sure her footprints don't come onto this road. Okay, so when you see my head hanging off the car like this, it means I'm looking for the tracks of the leopard. Now also, while I'm looking for the tracks, I'm also looking up in the trees in case they've put their meat in a tree. Leopard's the only big cat that will put meat up in a tree to protect it from lions and hyenas. And we're just going to check around the next bend. Caden would like to know, do any animals hibernate in Africa? No, what they do is estivate. So estivation is like hibernation, except we don't really get cold enough for the hibernating. So what they do is they do slow their heart rate down. So animals like tortoises, snakes, certain lizards will estivate, not hibernate. Okay, so I've got no sign of her tracks coming through here yet, so I'm going to turn around. And go back and have a look further down this road. Fingers crossed we find them. Now, sometimes it's quite difficult to see tracks. No, that's not a leopard track. Okay, I'm just going to be on the radio for a second. I just need to find out something quickly. Abel. Abel, did you get in cons over crossing west over Zoe's? So I'm asking if he saw tracks. So I'm just listening. Okay, copy, thanks. Okay, so I'm just getting an update. So one of the other safari guides was the last person with them, and he seemed to think they might cross, but I don't think so. I don't see any tracks here, so I'm gonna just double check. If there are no tracks here, it means they're in this area here somewhere, which is a much smaller area to check, which makes it a much better chance that we're gonna find them. If they cross over this road, there's a big area with no roads, which is gonna make it much more difficult to find them. So Destiny. Destiny is wondering, how long can a leopard live for? Well, Destiny, it depends. Females live longer than males. Your average female will live to about 14 or 15 years old in the wild. And they can live up to 19, but that's very, very rare. Males don't normally make it past sort of 12, 13 years old. But again, every situation is different, and sometimes they can live a lot longer than you think they're going to. Okay, so we're going really slowly, and if we get no leopard footprints here, it means they're certainly in here, so we'll go back and check carefully again. Now, leopards have very similar habits, even though they're not very closely related to the American mountain lion or cougar or puma. So their lifestyle is very similar, although a cougar is far more closely related to a cheetah than it is to a leopard. But their habits are very similar, solitary, with territories that they defend, and mothers will raise cubs until those cubs move away. Okay, now of course I'm not the only one trying to find these leopards. Jamie is out helping me on foot, so let's go see if she's had more luck than I have.
No leopards to show you yet, unfortunately, and Herbie's just walking up and down the road trying to help us find the tracks. And while he tries to help us find the tracks, I've found something to show you, but unfortunately it's feeling quite shy. It's all curled up on my hand. This, kids, is a millipede. And a millipede, like the animal that we saw earlier, or the dung that we saw earlier, is a herbivore. So it is a herbivore. It only eats a plant matter, so it's not scary. And picking it up isn't dangerous at all. The only potentially dangerous thing it might do is poo on me. But other than that, I'm not too worried about it. And when I was a kid, we always used to call them, nickname them Shongalolos. And we used to spend long, long times sort of sitting with them and letting them crawl over our skin and feeling the tickle of lots of their legs. But unfortunately, this one has decided he's feeling very, very shy. Now, this isn't something that is dangerous for me to touch, but if I were to eat it, it would make me sick as well. And that is because it is poisonous, so it is very dangerous to eat. Now, Liam, you want to know if there are any poisonous snakes out here. Well, just quickly, remember that poisonous, if something's poisonous, it means you, if you eat it, I'm not going to eat it. Sorry, millipede, I'm not going to eat you, I promise. If you eat it, it will make you very sick and possibly kill you. Something venomous is if it bites you or it stings you, then that is going to make you feel particularly unwell. So I'm going to put this millipede back where I found it, because he's all shy and he wants to stay tucked up and curled away. Oh, he pooped.
Look what I I found? I found a Herbie. Now, apparently Jamie's got some gremlins, so we're going to go check there. So, hi. So we do apologize for Jamie disappearing. This is live from the African bush. We found a Herbie on the road. Yes, Herbie just wanted to show me where he had tracks. I think the leopard is still behind us though, because if there's no tracks of the cubs coming this way. Herbie, your walking stick. Okay, so this side, Herb?
Yeah.
Okay.
If she's gone into Gallagher, you're all on your own.
You think she's crossed? Okay, so we're having a meeting now. So this is what a business meeting for us is. We're trying to decide where the leopard went. Now, it's quite a nice business meeting to have. I think she's still in this drainage line. Jamie and Herbie thinks she's over there. Vim, where do you think she is?
I was thinking that side.
No, I've checked the tracks. Were the tracks of the cubs crossing?
I haven't seen any tracks crossing apart from hers. It was just there. But that was because I was chattering
away. Yeah, so I say, till you show me cub tracks, she's this side. I'm going back that way.
You go back
that you way.
You go that way. We can't go that way.
Oh.
We've got no signal.
Okay, you go that way, I'll go check Gallagher shortcut.
Okay, alright. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, so, of course there's always a bit of discussion that happens at meetings. And, well, they've got the best chance of finding it to the south of us there, because they can really get into those little ravines that we can't get into in a car. And I said, until I see tracks of the cubs, I think she's still this side. As you can see, it's still quite cloudy today. We've had some nice rain, which has made the grass really long, which actually makes finding leopards quite hard sometimes. Okay, now I want to check carefully here. Now what we're hoping is that maybe one of the cubs is sleeping up in a tree. Hi, David. David says, when a leopard is born, does it know to hunt for its prey? Well, when a leopard is born, it is an altricial animal. Well, that means it's born blind and helpless in a den. And even at that young age, you would think the knowledge to hunt is still there. So they don't have to learn how to hunt. They have to practice to get better, like anything, but that knowledge is there. They're born with that knowledge. Oh, it's a kudu very far away. Now, that's not a good sign when you're looking for leopards straight where you are through that gap in the trees there. Keep going. Here we go, you can just see it's back through the bush there. You see it, Craig?
Yeah.
There we go. So that little thing there, that's an antelope. Now, it's good to know where the antelope are, because if they see a leopard, that particular antelope goes, bah, bah, to let all the other kudu know that there's a leopard around. Okay, where oh where has this leopard gone? Oh, there, what? Let's just have a quick look. Are those tracks there? Am I going to have to eat humble pie? Not yet. So I'm going to check a little bit further down here while we do that. Jamie's got some more dung to show you.
I do indeed, but before we quickly go on to that. Brent is absolutely right. It is very, very difficult to see the tracks at the moment. Now that's why we're stopping and investigating some of the exciting things that you might see out here. Earlier on, I asked you about that big pile of poo that was in the road, and Destiny, very well done, you said an elephant. Well done, Destiny. Very, very well done. You are absolutely right. It is an elephant. It contains a lot of grass at the moment, where sometimes you'll find branches and tree leaves mixed in. But at the moment, because the grass is so fresh and green and soft and yummy and sweet, the elephants are mostly eating grass. In winter, in our dry season, they'd be eating some twigs and sticks and leaves. And that's why we found that little bit of fruit in there as well. And of course, it's quite a big pile of poo. Now, I was happy to touch that big pile of poo, but I'm not happy to touch this pile of poo. So that gives you a hint. And Destiny and all the others, since you've all been so clever already, let's see if you can figure this puzzle out. This is the poo of an animal. And we'll call it scat because it comes from a predator. So predator poo is called scat. And herbivore poo is called dung. Now I'm trying to break it open. It's quite old, so it's gone hard. But can you see how powdery it is? Now you can see I'm not touching it with my hand. I'm touching it with a stick, because to touch it with my hand would be absolutely disgusting. Because it is an animal that eats meat, and all of the predators out here are not too fussy about the meat. They can't rush down to the grocery store and buy something freshly cling-wrapped and specially packaged. They have to go and catch what they can, and that might mean eating it over 3 days or 4 days on a hot summer's day. So they don't, any of our predators out here are not really known for the freshness of their meat eating. Except for two, but I'm not going to tell you what they are because that will give it away. So, what made this? Something that has made it go white. Now, Chastity, while we look at some predator dung, Chastity, you want to know, what does a hyena eat? Well, Chastity, a hyena, and they're one of my absolute favorite animals, and I hope somebody goes to the hyena den at some point this afternoon. Chastity, hyenas will eat meat. Now, of course, hyenas have a reputation for being really, really just dirty, thievy scavengers that don't do any hard work. They just go and steal things from the lions and the leopards. But that's not true. They can hunt as well. So they eat meat. They can eat bone. They've got very, very strong jaws and very potent stomach acid. So hyenas will eat meat, essentially, the same thing as any other carnivore. They also really like to eat car tires. Not actually eat for food, though. That's just because they like to chew on rubber, which is quite funny. They ate your toolbox? And they like to eat VM's toolbox as well. Hyenas like to eat lots of things. That was very rude of them, VM. Now, Elida, you want to know what the big difference is between a herbivore and a carnivore? Well, Elida, it's what they eat. So a herbivore will eat all of this. And generally you'll find that your herbivores are bigger than your carnivores. And that's because they can get bigger because there's more food available. You know, this is there's endless supplies of grass and trees and branches and all sorts of things like that. So a herbivore will eat different plants. But some herbivores eat different plants to others. So for example, if I were a zebra and I came wandering through here, I would only be eating the grass because I'm a grazer. Let's pretend I'm a zebra now. Pretend I'm really stripy. So I'd only be eating the grass. If I were a giraffe, I'd only be eating the leaves. If I were an elephant, which is a relative stretch of the imagination, if I were an elephant, I'd be eating everything, all the plants. But a predator eats meat. A carnivore eats meat. And pretty much meat only. Sometimes you see them eating grass, but that's because they feel sick, like your dogs or your cats. Ian, you say the answer. Wow, that's a new one. We have one guess that says cheetah. It's not a cheetah, but that was a very good guess because that is one of our predators that we get out here. I want another clue for you. There's more here. And then we have a suggestion that it is in fact a Komodo dragon. I'm afraid to say, whilst that is a very, very interesting guess, it is not in fact a Komodo dragon, just purely on the basis that unfortunately we don't get Komodo dragons out here. I'm quite disappointed personally, although I've always found Komodo dragons sort of terrifying looking. There's one pile there, there's another pile over here. So it's not a Komodo dragon. We do not get Komodo dragons in this particular place. We don't even get Komodo dragons, unfortunately, on the continent of Africa. There you'd have to go to the Komodo Islands to see a Komodo dragon. A Komodo dragon, for those of you that don't know, is the largest lizard species in the world, and it kills its prey because it has a really dirty mouth, and it's got toxins in its mouth bacteria, so it hunts something, bites them, and then eventually that animal starts to weaken along with the venom and the bacteria in the mouth. It starts to weaken and it collapses and dies. Not a pleasant death, I imagine. There's another pile of this white poo. So cheetah would probably have been a slightly closer guess than Komodo dragon, but Komodo dragon was quite a good one because reptiles don't urinate. And what that means is that, like birds, they excrete their urea in their dung, which is the color of white. But this is not urea, this is something else. This is something white, and you've seen it before. You've got it in your own body. Give it some thought, and while you think about it, let's go and see if Brent can distract you.
Oh dearie, dearie me. I've got a track of at least one leopard here, but the road is so hard and it's leaving the most tiny imprint. So I can't actually tell if there's three or one. So I'm just gonna keep going very, very slowly here. Eric would like some.
Well, it seems as though Brent has disappeared off your radar once again. We do apologize. I don't know what he was saying, but I'm sure it was something very interesting, and he will be deeply, deeply disappointed that he was not able to share it with you. Fortunately, Viam and myself now know the stretch of road relatively well, having walked up and down it a few times, just checking to see where these leopard tracks have gone off. So, have we given some thought to the answer to our question? What left the white scat, the white predator scat? It wasn't a cheetah and it wasn't a Komodo dragon. Definitely wasn't a bird. So what was it? And it's something that has marked, in fact, I would hazard a guess and say that those different piles of scat came from different animals. Same species, but different individuals. What might it be? Shall I give you another hint? Let me see if I can give you a hint that doesn't give it away. Carly, well done. Sorry, I got so enthusiastic about that, I choked myself. Okay, so it's not lion scat because it's not big enough and there's not enough hair, and generally lion scat doesn't go that white. But well done to Carly. You get some applause from me and presumably people around the world. Carly, well done. It is hyena scat. Very, very good. So the reason that it's white is because it comes from the calcium that they eat. So remember how we spoke about how hyenas eat bones and how their jaw strength is enough to crush it? They've also got a really strong stomach acid that dissolves it all. So in lion scat, or leopard scat, because they might eat a little bit of bone, you'll get chunks of bone in the scat itself. Whereas in hyenas, their stomach acid just dissolves everything to a powdery form. So that's calcium that makes your teeth white, makes your bones white, and of course makes your bones nice and strong. So that is why that scat is white. It comes from hyena. And they've all been marking their territory. Now hopefully at some point we will be able to show you some hyenas when you next join us on safari. Unfortunately, it seems as though it's time for you to go back to the rest of your normal school day. I hope you have a lovely day and that we see you soon. For the rest of you, let's head on back to Tayla.
Good afternoon again. We shall try this for a second time. My name is Tayla, and on camera with me this afternoon is Brian and the Thumb. But I must warn you, if you are younger than 16, close your eyes now, because the Thumb has got no clothes on. Look at him. It's the naked Thumb. How dare he? That's what I think the police are gonna come after you, Brian, you and your Thumb, the streaker. But yes, we are back. Wendy has gone into the hospital, and I may have kicked one of her tires as I walked away from her today as well, just to let her know that she's been very naughty. But we're on the jig jag now, and Jigger, nice Jigger, is behaving very well so far, so this is a wonderful start. Now, I know Brent and Herbert and the rest of the guides driving around are trying to figure out where Karula went. Oh, hello. Hang on, I found an animal, an impala. Now, please don't run away from us, because we haven't had the greatest of luck today, impala. There it is. Just one male impala hiding behind a tree. And I don't know what we're going to do just yet. We're going to scan around. We might go see if Tungana's out and about. Apparently he was spotted after game drive today. So we might go and scratch around there, around Weaver's Nest. I know Rexon is working that area at the moment. And I'm a little bit confused about Karula at the moment, because we were just minutes behind her this morning while we were on foot. And remember, we had seen her running tracks on the middle road. I wonder if she didn't catch an impala and she's just dragged it off into some of this thick vegetation. Remember, she could just be 20 or 30 meters off of the road and we wouldn't even know she was there. You can see even this impala disappears quite easily into the vegetation surrounding it, but giving us the death stare at the moment. And I don't blame it, because he is on his own. It must be a bit daunting, especially having a vehicle watching you. So he'll probably face us. But now he's relaxed. He's starting to munch away. What? Head up. Just making sure. Now you be safe, because if Karula's around, Mr. Impala, you might find yourself in a bit of trouble. And I think he knows that. There was a lot of commotion going on here this morning. Well, birds alarming, squirrels alarming, monkeys alarming. Look how he's smelling. Look at that, he's twitching his nose, definitely taking deep breaths. And those senses must be working overtime at the moment. Eyesight, he's watching us, his ears are listening elsewhere, and then he's probably smelling Brian's aftershave. What do you think? Mm-hmm. Are you wearing lots of aftershave? None? Not today, not trying to impress anybody today. Oh. Well, the Impala's pretty impressed, look how excited he's just got. And the wind is swirling a little bit here as well. We're in a bit of a thicket. But it's a good spot to be in, though, because at least you'll be able to hear better. It's not so breezy as it is out in the open. Look at all the flies covering his face, too. Oh, there we go. He uses his ears as a fly swatter, too. I don't know how they get used to it. There's nothing worse than having a fly hang around your ears or try and crawl up your nose or sit in the moisture in the corner of your eyes. And sometimes the impala, or all the animals, sort of just put up with it and they stare into the distance and just don't seem to be, well, too worried by it. And he is working overtime. His tail switching, he's twitching his coat, all his muscles on his body, which then makes the hair move. You can see that. Lifting up his legs, using his ears to swat the flies, everything. Take care, you. And you're agreeing with what I've said earlier. You said that you love the way that they just sort of stand and stare. And they do, they have to. You know, they can't just stick their heads in the grass and munch away, carefree. It's a tough life, especially if you are a prey species, like an impala. They feed many, many leopards around here. It's sort of one of the main things that they're feasting upon, especially at this time of the year. Luckily for the Steenbok and the common dacre, they get a little bit of a break. But then once winter comes about, they tend to head, and well, the leopards start going for the smaller items again. But I've noticed here in Southland, I haven't seen any leopards yet. I'm eating warthogs since I've been here. I missed the amazing sighting that Jamie had with the Anderson male. And no, VM was very ecstatic about that, where he took a warthog up a tree. I didn't get to see that. But down in the southern sector of the Sabi Sands, the leopards love to eat warthogs there. I saw the big male, Mashabeni. He used to often catch warthogs, as well as there's another young male, speaking about him the other day, a White Dam's young male. He always used to catch warthogs too. The two of them were warthog killing machines. And not just little warthogs either, not these little cute little piglets that we're seeing running around, big strong boys. And we know that a warthog is not an easy thing to take down. Impala, I think you're a little bit easier. I think if I was a leopard, I'd rather challenge you than challenge a big warthog boar. That makes me, makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up a little bit when I just think of that. You've seen how fast they can run. They're like a cannonball shooting, especially when they come flying out of those termite mounds. I wouldn't let anything, well, they don't let anything stand in their way. Hello, boy. Where's your friends? I wonder if there aren't any more impala lurking around here somewhere. Now, Kathy, you were wondering if animals' facial expressions... did you hear what you said? Asymmetrics? Facial features are more symmetrical, there we go, sorry, than humans. I don't know if animals are that aware. I think we as humans, what do you think, Brian? Do you think we have a lot more facial features? I think we're utilizing them a lot more. If I look at myself and if I look at all the screenshots that you all send of me, the faces that I'm pulling in those shots are unbelievable. I didn't even know I could do some of those things. I don't know. It's an interesting one. I think humans are sort of, we are doing it more. I don't think impala and animals do it as much as we as humans do. You see them twitching their nose and they do the Fleming grimace and they'll stare. There we go. Like you have that sort of excited look in their eyes sometimes, especially you see it with Hosanna and Shongile. You see when they're a little bit slightly disappointed, like when Hosanna gives Shongile the slip this morning, you saw that she was slightly concerned as to where her brother had gone. You can definitely see that, but I think it's more obvious in humans. And now he's hiding. Right, let's carry on. Let's see what else we can find down the road. I'm just triple checking. I'm also helping Brent and everybody else around here just have a look. Hi, Mr. Impala. Now we'll probably find some more Impala around here. And seeing as though we were chatting about him, thank you for sending all the questions through, by the way. If you'd like to send questions about anything that we're seeing out here, hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv is an email address. Now, Shannon, you were asking, how old do I think that impala is? I think he's a relatively old boy. Just from looking at the size of his horns, they've definitely grown to their maximum. I don't think that they'll get any bigger than that. And he looks a little bit tired, so I think he's been around for a couple of years. I would put his age at about, just guessing now, of course, I would say 7 or 8. And they don't normally live for too much longer than about 10 years, give or take a little bit around there, sort of like a big dog. They live for about that long, maybe even a little bit longer. But it's not, most of the animals out here don't ever make it to the oldest that they'll ever get to, because they get eaten, unfortunately. Well, it's very sad to be a prey species. Your chances of survival out here are, well, quite slim, but then also, so are the younger animals. So like when leopards and lions are born, their success rate is not always as high as well. Oh, Rebecca, there's that word that you said you must stop saying, but I'm saying it all the time this afternoon. Today, I'm not allowed to say the word as well. That needs to be removed from my vocabulary, so we shall attempt to do that this afternoon. Brian? What are you going to do if I say the word as well?
I'll flick your ear.
Brian's going to flick my ear if I say the word as well. Oh, I can't even say it. That's a good start. Now, Alice, you're wondering if antelope will also sleep during the day? They sort of, I suppose you could say they have these little resting periods, but it's not necessarily that they're having a nap. Oh, there's lots of birds here. There's a little bird party. Let's see if they land again. There's a hoopoe in the middle of the road. So Alice, what the antelope tend to do is they normally will rest during the day. They might sit down if it's very hot under the shade of a big tree, and then they'll ruminate. So they will regurgitate their food that has been partially digested and re-chew it again for the final process of digestion. So that's typically it. And then I suppose you could count that as a little nap. But it's tough out here because these antelope species, they can't rest like a lion would do. They can't just go to sleep. Because if they do that, then anything could come up behind them and will eat them. And they don't want that. So they're always looking around. And remember, the impala, the most energy that herbivores are doing every single day, or using every single day, is probably their digestive process, especially if they are a ruminant, so if they've got those four chambers in their stomachs. Look at this, hoopoe. This is an African hoopoe, and it's looking for food, but now it's also having a dust bath. See, it's trying to almost like loosen the soil there a little bit, and then you'll see it has a little shake. Come on. No, now you're done. It was just a mini dust bath. When they really get into it, they create quite a bit of dust, which can be quite beautiful. But there's a lot happening on this road. Lovely long bills with a sensory nerve running down the center of it so that they can feel any insects moving around underneath the ground. Let's see if it gets lucky. What do you think? A beetle or a grub? What do you think it's going to pull out of the ground first, Brian?
A grub.
I'm going to go with a beetle. I think it's going to pull a beetle out of the ground. Let's see. We'll have to now wait until this hoopoe does catch something. I don't know if it's searching in the right areas. This doesn't look like a very good area where there's lots of food. The other afternoon we watched a hoopoe, and everywhere it probed, it was pretty amazing. It got very lucky. It would pull something out of the ground. And these poor birds, seeing as though we were just speaking about feeding habits of impala, birds as well, they're on the go 24/7 looking for things to eat. And that's what they do, is they go about, and depending on the bird, but we're looking at the hoopoe, they'll forage down on the ground like they are right now. Just probing along. There we go, got a little something. Oh, that was too small to tell what that was. It was teeny tiny. Come on. And did you notice how they don't actually probe too much of their bill? I always thought that they'd stick it right into the ground. Oh, hey, that's why it ran away. There was a mongoose that darted out in front of the road. We'll see if we can find it again, just at this fallen log. And that poor African... No, now I can't go. Yeah, into reverse. There we go. No, now I've stalled. These vehicles are all so different. This clutch is slightly more sensitive. Right, let's see if this mongoose is here. So it just ran across, and then it ran into this little woody section here where this bush willow has been pushed over by the elephants many, many moons ago. Where are you? Don't know why that noise always seems to work. They're fascinated by that squeaky noise, and then they will pop their heads up. Not today. I can't imagine they'd be very, very active though. Very, very interesting. Just one lurking around here. Maybe the others are hiding away in some of this long grass. We're in search of something a little bit bigger. We might go and check where I had some buffalo tracks to see if we can find some buffalo. But we're going to go across to Brent now. And then, well, the bird that's whispered in my ear says that he's not in his vehicle anymore. Let's go find out.
Oh, dearie, dearie me. This is destiny. One of the toughest tracks I've tracked in the last little while. Some really hard substrate. And before I forget, we don't have much pie out here in the bush. So I'll eat a humble leaf. They did go north. We found their tracks again. And we followed them over some really, really tough stuff. And this is the furthest I've ever seen Kula take the cubs north so far. And the tracks are approaching the boundary. I'm just hoping she turns either left or right instead of straight across, but we're about to find out. So tracks of all three. Blah. Blah. That was a foul tasting bush willow, but I deserved it for being that cheeky. But at least we've managed to keep on the tracks for this long. And this is the moment of truth, so to speak, as we arrive at the northern edge of our traverse. Have they turned left? Have they turned right? I have got the sinking sensation that they've gone straight. But this is a busy road, lots of people up and down. So, we shall check on foot. Please do not have gone straight. So, of course, this is an access road, so there's been quite a lot of vehicles here. So I've just got to check that extra bit carefully that we don't miss the tracks, and they actually are still on our side somewhere. There's been tractors here today, lots of movement. Okay, cursory examination. Feeling a bit more hopeful. Tertiary examination. Now, of course, we're now dancing on the edge. Now, there's also lion tracks here this morning. I know Tristan saw these from the Nkuhumas. Okay. Oh, this is tough on this road. Now, we've been doing a lot of this today. While you haven't been with us, stopping, getting out of the car, checking very, very carefully. Now, the last track I had was there. I'm going to just check under this bush. No, not under that bush. But that has happened to me before. And you've always got to be quite careful. I'm just going to check again up this side. As I said, there's been tractors and stuff. So I'm actually just looking for the slightest sort of half track or something like that. But we don't want to find them here. I'm not seeing any, but as I said, the tractor might. So Rexon's just arrived from behind me. And I'm not sure where they went, so I'm just going to have a quick chat with Rexy, because he's going to go down this road, I think, eh? Last tracks are just behind you, yeah, like in the middle of the road, all three. But there's been a Gunda Gunda and stuff. Okay, so Rex is going to go past us, go check a bit more carefully. I'm going to go back to the last tracks and take a walk, see if we can find them on foot. Let's fingers crossed that they haven't gone that way. So while I ponder which way the royal family has vanished in, let's go back to Jamie, who's looking around some hyena dens.
It's okay, Brent. We'll try and find the royal family for you. I don't have to eat humble pie. I'm just eating a nice sweet panicum grass stalk. It was so funny when I passed on that message to Herbie, just as though to casually emphasize a point, he just did that. With his feet in the road, which is the way trackers mark tracks in the road, just casually. The last track that he had of Kruder coming up north this road certainly got a sense of humour, our Herbie. I've just taken a brief break from our Karula tracking to come and visit a very old, very dear site, the old hyena den off Gallego Shortcut. And I wonder, we spent many hours watching November tumble up and down this particular termite mound. I wonder whether they'll move back here at some point, whether Ribbon will bring her cubs here and we will witness those scenes once again. Definitely not active, given that the entire main entrance hole is blocked up by grass. There is no sign of any hyenas. They've walked along this road a few times, but there's definitely nobody home in the hyena den itself. But we really did enjoy some wonderful moments here. This is when November the hyena cub was whooping when he was only a few weeks old. Woo! Woo! So cute. One of the cutest things I've ever seen a hyena ever do. There you go. That's where Pretty used to lie and Corky and the December twins used to pop out. Definitely nobody home anymore. I absolutely adore spending time with the hyenas and at a hyena den. Pandasonic, you want to know what is my favorite thing to see out here? It's so hard to tell you that, the answer to that. I love seeing elephants. I love spending time with them. I really enjoy spending time with the hyenas, but equally, it's exciting when we find leopards. It's exciting to see wild dogs. If I had to tell you, probably, my favorite thing to see out here, I'm eating panicum seeds, by the way. Must keep our strength up for this Karula tracking exercise. I have to tell you, I think my favorite thing to see out here is something unexpected, something unusual, and something that we don't expect to find. So, for example, mongoose moving babies around with vim, anything like that, anything quite unexpected and unique. Strange new species of baboon spider that I've never seen before. Things like that really make my day. Snakes and mongoose, and not that I don't love seeing the bigger creatures, and if I don't see them for too long then I start to get withdrawal symptoms, but those are definitely one of the things I enjoy the most. It's also nice to get a surprise predator sighting. I know VM enjoys a good surprise leopard sighting or wild dog sighting or something, and so do I, because often, especially in the afternoons, there's a chance that we know where we're going at the beginning of the drive, and we know roughly where we're going. So it's quite nice to just have something unexpected. Let's not walk too close to the... Let me just check the entrance to this den first. There might be a warthog living in this side. I'm not 100% confident this bit isn't active. I don't want a warthog to come sprinting out at us. I'll be devastated. And quite possibly flat. Are you going to try and get that spider hunting wasp, Bim? Sure, that's ambitious. Ah, now, let me just go up there and see. Poke my head in. Ooh, looks suspiciously active. And on a nice cool day like today. Hello? Knock, knock. Anybody home? Definitely warthog tracks around here. There's the spider hunting wasp. That's what I was after. There we go. They like to gather around these termite mounds because the burrows attract spiders, because they're attracted to the flies that are attracted to the animal living inside them. And then the spider hunting wasps come along and search for spiders to hunt in the entrances to these den sites. Cool. Pretty, really pretty. But we cannot delay too long on this leopard search, otherwise it's going to get dark, so we better start striding off. And as we continue on the search for the leopards, it seems as though Taylor's found something that has been even more scarce than leopards in the past few days, and that is a buffalo.
We have got a buffalo who has just woken up. As you can see, it's sort of in a little bit of a hunched up position, not quite ready to start the afternoon just yet. But these two, there's actually two of them, these two Dugger boys, these big buffalo bulls, have been fast asleep, and well, it's time for the daily constitution, as you can see. And that's also very typical, and especially of buffalo, is after they've had a long siesta of, ruminating their food, and buffalo sneak asleep in every now and then. They need to, do their daily deeds before they start moving around again. And here they are. And I haven't seen buffalo in such a long time. It's been ages. So what a treat. Even though it's just two boys and not a big herd storming through Djuma, these two will just have to do. But they're big. And Brian and I were discussing that you don't realize how big these animals are until you are standing on the ground looking at them in the eye. And from a vehicle, a buffalo doesn't look like too much. but they are one of the most underestimated animals out here. They can be very, very scary. Still busy, my goodness. Now, Tidge, you've asked this afternoon what is the strongest animal out here. I would say in relation to its size, probably an elephant. I mean, elephants can pull and push down trees without any problems. I've seen video footage of elephants picking up buffalo and picking them up off the ground and throwing them. There was an amazing video that we saw. This buffalo decided that it was going to try and stand up to a breeding herd, which didn't end up very well, unfortunately, for the buffalo. But the elephants are the king of the jungle out here. They are unbelievable. They chase lions away. And they're pretty incredible animals too. Now, apparently, there's just a little bit of pixelation that you may have seen a moment ago. I do apologize for that. The gremlins are hitting us hard. We might have to sing the gremlin song again that I'd made up about them this morning. I probably need to work on verse 2, but I think now that Brian's here, verse 2 could be quite exciting. And the oxpeckers are no stranger to sitting on the back of a buffalo. This is a noisy one. Just shouting about, talking to the other oxpeckers that are around. And Leo, you just asked us right now if the ticks can harm the animals in the bush. Well, Leo, luckily for these animals, they have a friend, and that friend is this oxpecker that is sitting on the back of the buffalo. And they're incredible. They are able to remove all the parasites, and particularly the red-billed buffalo. Not the red-billed buffalo weaver, the red-billed oxpecker. They specifically are going for all the little tiny ticks, so the pepper ticks and the tick larvae, and I'm sure there'll be all sorts of mites and fleas and things on there that also suck the blood of the buffalo, so they get rid of those. Or what they'll do is, if you have a look at this buffalo over here on the left, it's having a scratch at the moment. So another way that they try and combat the ticks is they'll lie in muddy water for quite some time and soak themselves, and then they'll go up to a tree, and that mud would have dried on their bodies, and then the ticks would have suffocated, and then they scrape them off on a tree like that. But this one is just having a scratch. The animals out here, though, are pretty resilient. They are not affected too badly by the ticks. If they have a weakened immune system, so say there's something else wrong with them, there's sort of underlying problems, then yes, massive populations of ticks on an animal could probably harm them. But like I said, they are so tough. They are used to being faced with all sorts of viruses and bacteria. Oh, a comb-billed duck, but it's flying very far. Will he get it, Brian? Will he get it? Yes, he can! Yes, he can! You biscuit! Well done, Brian. I just threw that one out there. That is amazing. Well done. And it was a male, too. It was a comb-billed duck. Very nice. Just casually passing over the heads of the buffalo. I don't know where it's going. It might be going actually towards a dam. So keep an eye out at on the dam cam. You might see that bird make a landing. Probably at the bottom pan where the Egyptian geese like to hang about. I reckon that they will probably be there somewhere. Boys, I'm going to go. Let's reposition. Let's quickly go the other side and get another view. Whee! They're having a scratch. They're not really starting their day off with a bang. They seem to be going quite slowly. Hi, boys. You are smelly. They don't smell very nice today. There we go. They're actually quite young boys. They don't look particularly old. Their horns don't look too worn. And also, he's got a little bit of a dewlap. Hello. Thank you for looking at us, Grumpy. But I think that these boys are in the prime of their life at the moment, and particularly this one over here. How beautiful is he? Now, Titch, you were wondering if buffalo are dangerous. They are indeed. They are an animal that don't give too many sort of warning signs when they're unhappy with you. They're also particularly good at licking their noses with their tongues, as you just saw there. So in a vehicle, it's not so bad. You're pretty safe in a vehicle. However, we had an instance the other day where we had a buffalo charge us. I was with David. David's on holiday. Oh, hello, oxpeckers. Look at all of them. There's the juveniles. You see them opening their mouths in the middle? Stop. starving. Absolutely starving, those two. And that's perhaps who that oxpecker was calling earlier. Maybe it was shouting out to call the little ones back again. That's cute. That's like a little family. Isn't that lovely? Little portrait. It's a bit early to do portrait pictures this year. Normally you only do them around Christmas. They're a bit excited. So as I was saying is that, so we had this buffalo. She ended up having a broken leg though. And I was trying to warn James and Herbert not to come and walk in this area because she was very, very angry and we were quite a distance away. And as I was relaying that message across to Rebecca to tell James, this David started shouting, "She's charging, she's charging," and this buffalo started charging our vehicle. Luckily I shouted and I clapped my hands and she turned a couple of meters just before the vehicle. But they can, you gotta watch out for them. You just never know with buffalo. And like I said, on foot is probably the most dangerous. Especially if you surprise them, they're not going to be too happy with you. And these boys as well. Oh, that is beautiful. And you can very easily see that the one on the left is a juvenile. Hasn't got the red bill. And it hasn't got the yellow ring around its eye. It's still got, I wouldn't be able to tell you how old it is. It's probably only a few months old. And that's actually interesting. I'm not sure when they start to develop the red on their beak and the yellow around their eyes. And you've also got two buffalo. Now they've got one adult, one juvenile. Now, Kathy, we've heard what noise the oxpeckers make, but you're wondering what noise the buffalo makes. And I know why. Rebecca's asked me this, so I'd make a buffalo call. Hey, Rebecca, that's exactly what you want me to do. Well, I won't do it here. But a buffalo sounds very much like a cow. So sort of, I'll do it now. Oh, well, that actually worked. There we go. You saw it got a reaction. We did that very, very softly as well. I didn't do it loud at all. And it's just like a cow noise. And I don't know. I hope I said something nice to you, mister. I didn't mean to say anything offensive. I'm just learning your local language. Nope, he doesn't seem too upset by it, which is good. Because I'm very close. Well, they're walking very close to us. So yes, and just typically the sounds that cows make, that's the noises that a buffalo will make too. Oxpeckers, you guys are very chatty today. Always talking. And look at their feet. Look at those incredible toes that they've got. And those feet are amazing. And they're able to cling onto the buffaloes while they're moving around. They can hang upside down. They can do all sorts of wonderful things. And if you ever get to watch oxpecker acrobatics, you must definitely take an opportunity. If you do come out on a safari, or we'll see if these two decide to do something along those lines today. But the little one looks a bit cold. They both do. See how they're all quite puffed up and sitting sort of quite flat against the buffalo? That's the nicest thing. They don't just benefit by feeding on the buffaloes, but they also get warmth from them too. Hello. Well, that's exciting that these two have reared two chicks. And I'm sure now that the age that they're at, I'm sure that they will survive and make it towards adulthood. It's normally the initial stages of a bird in a nest. If it'll be able to fledge. And then once they've fledged, normally they're pretty suited. Ah, now they're taking off from one buffalo to another. And our other friend has decided that he's not going out. He's just, this is a good enough spot. He's going to hang around here for the rest of the day. Look how sad he looks. That was perfect. Oh, woe is me. I'm just a sad buffalo. Yeah, buddy, I've got news for you. It's just the start of the week. It's Monday. He doesn't look impressed at all. But these are two good-looking buffalo. They would give them kahumas a run for their money. Oh, look at that natural framing you've got there, Brian, between the horn and the oxpecker. That's very lovely. Now, Kathy, yes, you've asked if what would be the predator of an oxpecker, not any of the raptors. So you might find something like a lizard buzzard, a Warburg's eagle, a gymnogene or an African harrier hawk. Any one of the raptors would go for something like an oxpecker if they could catch them. And actually, particularly an African harrier hawk.
you might find going after the chicks of the red-billed oxpeckers or the yellow-billed oxpeckers, because they make their nests in holes in trees. And we know that the African harrier hawk, let me get a photo out for you. That means I have to, oh, and my earpiece has come out. I'll have to open my app on my mobile. Let me open that for you so we can show you right what an African harrier hawk looks like. And this is always a hard one to find. Let's try, there we go. No, I lied, that was an easy one. Okay, you ready to see what an African harrier hawk looks like? Here it is. Here we go. Or a gymnogene is the other name. Now they're incredible. They're able to bend their legs around, so it's quite easy for them to stick their legs down into a hole in a tree. They'd struggle often with knob thorns digging away and looking for chicks. So that would probably, I reckon that would probably be the biggest threat to an oxpecker. Otherwise, there's not really too much. I don't know of any raptors that would be brave enough to swoop down and snatch an oxpecker off of the back of a buffalo or a giraffe. It would be pretty impressive though. I'd like to see that. Right, let's reposition once more. Let me see if I can, oh, no, sorry, jig-jag. Let's quickly go around. Boys, you're making us do loop-dilly-loops today. Don't mind us. Look how relaxed they are. This is fantastic. Hi, gentlemen. You're not really bothered by us at all. Now, looking at a buffalo, it's actually quite nice because these boys don't look like they've been bathing in mud for quite some time. You can actually see their coat quite nicely, and the hair actually looks like it's thickening slightly. And Stephen, you were wondering how thick the hair is on a buffalo's coat, or is it as thin as what it looks like. I've never touched a buffalo. I'm just trying to think. No, maybe I have touched a buffalo, but when, like, many, many years ago, because I helped with a lot of game captures, and I think buffalo could have been one of them. But when I say many years ago, I was probably like between 10 and 13. But you can see, you can actually see the skin in some parts of it. So I don't think it's very thick. I don't even think the hair is quite as thick as a domestic cow. I think it's slightly thinner than that. But also, with this chilly weather that we've had about, I think they've fluffed their coats up a little bit. There we go. You can see there's an old wound. And just by looking at that, you can see the hair must also be quite, like, bristly. I don't think it would be very smooth. I think it's a bit more coarse. But that's an old injury, whether it was a horn from another buffalo, from an argument. But it looks quite like quite an old injury. It's healed up nicely. It's completely, scab is completely closed. Even just from scratching itself on a tree, maybe it hit an unfortunate part of the tree and it opened up the skin. And then this is where the oxpeckers come in, and it's sort of not so favorable for the buffalo. Because what happens is these oxpeckers are feeding on the blood of the animal. So it's not necessarily that they're going after the tick, but they're after the blood, and they will peck at wounds like that. Yes, you four, I'm talking about you. And they can become quite a pain because they'll keep reopening wounds. They won't cause serious damage. I mean, they won't be the cause that the animal would have ended up dying. But then there's just a lot of flies hanging around again, and it takes a little bit longer for the wound to heal. Lovely. Oxpeckers, you have been absolutely wonderful, but we're going to move off in just a moment as this one does a bit of preening, and we're going to send you back across to Brent, who has sadly given up for the search of the leopards.
Well, given up is the incorrect word, but we do have some white-faced owlets. Aren't they absolutely stunning? I do love these two. They're proper little shapeshifters. Isn't that so cool? They are such cool little owls. Now, they're snoozing at the moment. So quite often when they're snoozing, they make themselves tall and skinny. And you can see their eyes are closed. Look at that. The eyes are almost completely closed. Now, this has led me to decide to ask you a question. Now, how many owl species do you think we get here in the Sabi Sands? how many owl species do we get in the Sabi Sands? If you know the answer, let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at WildEarthTV. Very, very cool little dudes. Isn't that cool? Okay, we're going to keep moving. I think I'm going to head down towards Chitwa. See what's happening there. So, Craig was out with Rebecca doing signal testing on Wendy. You didn't do such a good job, did you, Batman? The face was quite priceless. I wish I could have showed you. And so, they, on their signal testing adventures, they down there, so we Rebecca says they saw too many animals. Why Wendy's not working? Wendy needs a holiday. But well, we'll see. We're gonna go. Could be. Let's go have a look, see if we can find some tracks, and see what's happening there. Sorry about that. Apparently, we had a little bit of breakup there. So I was telling Craig that obviously while they were doing their signal testing, it wasn't very good because Wendy went down again this afternoon. But they did manage to find a leopard. So we're going to go see if we can find that leopard again. It could be Tundi or it could be her cub. And Craig, was it a male or female?
Female.
I think it was a female. Okay, cool. So it could be Tundi. So we're gonna meander down to the east, see what we can find there. And if we have no luck, Tingana was also seen this morning around the boundary of Djuma, so he might cross in a little bit later. Ooh, it's getting a bit nippy. I think I'm putting my jersey on. Now, of course, we've got the guys out from Biome who are doing the VR stuff at the moment, and they're completely nuts. They're from England. We're sitting in, Craig's got jackets, long pants, and a jersey. I've got long pants, boots, and I'm now putting a jersey on inside out. And I'm thinking, I've got two jackets spare. And these guys are rolling around in shorts, t-shirts, and flip-flops. And they're saying, it's such lovely weather. Of course, that just makes me remember how bad the weather is in the UK, if they think this is lovely weather. 23 degrees is not lovely. 23 degrees Celsius, 74 Fahrenheit. For me, that's nippy. My optimum temperature is somewhere around 30. Rexon's getting hold of me. He was following Karula's tracks into Buffalo's Hook, so maybe he's got an update for me.